Well, good morning, everyone. My name is David Kisor, and I am musical director at New Thought Unity Center, and we are here in Cincinnati, Ohio, on a lovely fall morning. It's true. Autumn is here, and it's been a wonderful week of beautiful weather. And for all our earth-loving family out there, the equinox came, and at the same time of a beautiful half-moon that night, we're in the middle of High Holy Days for our Jewish family, and Rosh Hashanah comes tomorrow when we atone once again in this brand new year. And so we welcome everyone, whatever your faith, whatever your belief, and whatever you have on. We can't see you at home, and maybe that's a good thing. I don't know. But I can see everybody here in the sanctuary and smiling behind their masks. And so everyone, every creature, all that is love and all that is made from love, which is all things, we bring them all in at this point. Bring 'em all in, bring 'em all in, bring 'em all in, bring 'em all in, bring 'em all into my heart. Bring 'em all in, bring 'em all in, bring 'em all in, bring 'em all in, bring 'em all into my heart. Bring the little fishes, bring the sharks, bring them from the brightness, bring them from the dark. Bring 'em all in, bring 'em all in, bring 'em all in, bring 'em all in, bring 'em all in. Bring 'em all in, bring 'em all in, bring 'em all in, bring 'em all in, bring 'em all into my heart. Bring them from the caverns, bring them from the heights, bring them from the shadows, stand them in the light. Bring 'em all in, bring 'em all in, bring 'em all in, bring 'em all in, bring 'em all in. Bring 'em all in, bring 'em all in, bring 'em all in, bring 'em all in, bring 'em all into my heart. Bring them out of Purda, bring them out of store, bring them out of hiding, lay them at my door. Bring 'em all in, bring 'em all in, bring 'em all in, bring 'em all in, bring 'em all into my heart. Bring 'em all in, 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 bring 'em all in. Bring the unforgiven, bring the unredeemed, bring the lost and nameless, let them all be seen. Bring them out of exile, bring them out of sleep, bring them to the portal. Lay them at my feet. Bring 'em all in, bring 'em all in, bring 'em all in, bring 'em all in, bring 'em all into my heart. Ooh, ooh, ooh. Bring 'em all in, bring 'em all in, bring 'em all in, bring 'em all in.
them all in, bring 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 them all, bring them all, bring them all in, 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 bring
them all in, bring them all in, And the dog brought something in this morning from out west. And there is the master of I-74 who came to us again today. Uh-huh. Everybody welcome David Allen Brown.
Look what the dog drug in. Uh-huh. It's so great to be here again as your guest speaker and to be doing this often and seeing your amazing presence, the extraordinary divinity that you bring and even that we feel through the universal energy that ties us together, and maybe we nicknamed it the World Wide Web, but we know all of the iterations of the World Wide Web here at Unity. We begin with something that empowers us to move through our lives, our days, our moments. It's our affirmation, and so let's share it together. Today it is, I go forth to look upon Christ's face. Won't you say that with me? I go forth to look upon Christ's face. Let us pray. Mother, Father, God, thank you. Everywhere we look, we see the glory of God manifest. Every living thing brought to us by the glorious and delightful circumstance put in place to challenge us and invite us into the power of love, the glory of atonement, and the peace of healing. Today we accept this glorious gift, knowing in our hearts that all things we bring there are true and perfect and the image of God. Us too, and together that means perfection, that means healing, that means progress, that means miracles, and it means unconditional love flowing around, into, through, and out of us to make the world a better place. And so it is. Amen.
That's Randy Winters on the drums, ladies and gentlemen. And we have Michael Barrett on the bass. Playing up for him. Peg Buchanan on the fiddle. And we have Alice, and we have Althea singing for you. And now everybody else is going to stand up. And let's get a shot, a back shot of the entire sanctuary choir. And we're going to bring it in together because we are one in the spirit. Here we go.
We are one in the Spirit, we are one in the Word. We are one in the Spirit, we are one in the Word. And they'll know we are family by our love, and they'll know we are family by our love. We are one in the Spirit, we are one.
now's, woohoo! Now's the time when we greet one another with a hello and a hi and a virtual hug and make some noise. Shout to somebody across there. Your water droplets will stay in your mask. Yes, and for all of those who are at home, we welcome you and we're thankful that you're here and we're thankful. We're waving at each other. We see the usual suspects all around here. Those seekers of light, people on the path, all here together today. All right, let's kick it up one time and sing a little bit. One, two, three.
Have a seat. Let's reaffirm our vision and our mission for why we gather, why we support, why we know love will win out. Won't you say the mission statement with me? In God, we are an inclusive, abundant community, experiencing love, transforming lives, and serving others. And through those actions, our vision will be manifest. Together with me, we celebrate a world of harmony and oneness, a place of loving stewardship, sacred connections, and pure joy, where all are welcomed with honor and respect. And this is our vision for the entire of humanity, and we live it here each day, welcoming all with honor and respect. If you've ever been in a place or landed in an atmosphere in which you did not feel welcome or accepted for exactly who you are and the glorious manifestation of God that you are, know that here in this place, you are welcome. And we are so glad that you are here. If it's your first time surfing to this site or coming through these doors, please know that there's staff members and board members and volunteers who would love to talk to you more about what Unity is, what it stands for, what the mission of New Thought Unity Center is, and all of the great things that are happening here, including membership and programs and on and on and on. It just keeps going in wonderful ways. Tell us some of those ways, David.
Absolutely. We've got a lot of things going on today, and this being the first Sunday in fall, we are going to do falling leaves announcements. All right, here we go. They started already. I've been hiking. Karaoke, Friday, October 9th at 7 p.m. in Friendship Hall with Kim Ballou. Kim is here today. You can give her your favorite song, and she will have it ready for you on Friday. And even if you don't do that, come and sing through your mask. It's a wonderful opportunity to gather and to enjoy music. Sufi Celebration of Divine Love. Yes, the Sufi celebrations are back October the 7th. That's a Wednesday at 6:30. We're going to do it in person here in the sanctuary, spread out like we are right now, and it will also be streamed on Facebook Live. Mastermind Group, October the 4th and 18th. The topic is The Greater Connection, held at 7:30 via Zoom. Alice at soulpurpose.net, that's Alice Frazier, and or call the center for pre-registration during the Zoom link. Oh, there was just a leaf. Did you see that? Galleria of Gift Shop. Oh, no, let's do spiritual cinema first. And this Friday, it's going to be the movie Michael. And John Travolta, a perennial favorite. He won't be dancing much in this movie, but he will be flying around, I think. And we're going to see the movie, and we're going to talk about it. And so come at 6:30. Movie starts at 7. Bring your drink, and we'll have the popcorn. Galleria of Grace gift shop. It's back open, ladies and gentlemen. After a little hiatus, you can go and get the handmade items there. And that all benefits the center. Angel's Wings retail shop, lots of Halloween items. I went in there, there were like mice and bats. Not real ones, but things on the table. There's a whole bunch of things there. And also, we want to, so you can look at that. What? $1 clearance items? I didn't even read the announcement. 25% off everything else. Open till 3 o'clock today. Flagpole fundraiser. GoFundMe page has been established to raise funds for the flagpole in front of NTUC to hold the Black Lives Matter and the LGBTQ flags. So donate to the flags. And you can also show your support for what we believe, and that is that everything matters. Black Lives Matter yard signs are for sales at the Angel Wings gift shop for $20. I have a $20 bill, and it's burning a hole in my duct tape wallet to buy one of those signs today. And that's what I'm going to do after this. Enjoy the autumn falling leaves.
Yay. Thank you, David. All that business aside, let's do something holy. Holy also. Also holy. Let's be still and go with him. Take a deep breath and release. And again, a deep breath and release. At Unity, we meditate to reconnect with Source, to remind us of the ever-present love and power that is ours, and that through conscious thought we can reconnect with, become re-empowered, reinvigorated, and know the worth of our soul. And we take a deep breath. And as we exhale, we allow the furniture that we are on to absorb the weight of our bodies, for gravity to take hold, our muscles to relax, and release any distractions. Take all things out of your hand. Place your feet flat on the floor, otherwise be comfortable. If it feels right to you, I invite you to close your eyes or otherwise divert your attention and take a deep breath. And in our mind's eye, we create the space that is ours alone, an image of comfort, peace, prosperity, love. There is a simple breeze or a gentle flowing water here, something on which, if thoughts arise from the outside world, we simply set them adrift and instead focus on the warm light and the perfection of the serene scene we have created. For us, this is our reconnection to the divine, and we invite it in. And today we invite a new perception, a reminder of all things holy. We choose to see a world forgiven, and where everywhere we look, we see the face of Christ. Today I choose to see a world forgiven. And we enter into the peace with this calming and yet powerful thought. I choose to see a world forgiven. The world is forgiven. Today we are indeed blessed. As we become more aware of the world around us, we bring the power of our connection to the mind of God with us. We see with the sight of God, and we go forth and see the God in all things. Blessed indeed. Blessed. Indeed.
How could anyone ever tell you you were anything less than me?
He lost his wife of 40 years without a reason to go on living without her. Until he saw that sad and scrawny dog shaking and scared at the animal shelter. Step by step they walked through hell, did what it took to make it through. Till in the end it was hard to tell who rescued who. A young man, wild and restless, headed for sure destruction. No brakes, no throttle. Until he met old timer at the meeting and found redemption at the bottom of a bottle. Step by step, they walked through hell, did what it took to make it through. Till in the end it was hard to tell who rescued who. Man, you think you see on the outside, strong and sure, well put together. Inside there's a shadow of a broken boy caught in endless stormy weather. Step by step we walk through hell, never sure of what to do. Shaking and scared he looks at me the way I look to you. Let's do what it takes to finally make it through. Till in the end no one can tell who rescues who. Step by step we walk through hell, never sure of what to do. Shaking and scared you look at me the way I look to you. Let's do what it takes to finally make it through. Till in the end no one can tell who rescues who.
That's a new song?
Yes.
You just wrote that? Like, well, not just, but...
Yeah, so sometimes David and I talk about what's coming on next week, and so last Sunday you planted a seed, and it, like, grew into a song this week, so it was very, very cool.
Well, that's great. Yeah, it's amazing, right. Yeah, as someone said, you know, how's it feel to be the inspiration for all these songs? I'm like, no. No credit at all. I just mentioned this dog, and then out comes this. This dog is, that's Gus. Gus lives at our house now. He has for about 3 months. He's about 5 months old. He's a rascal. What you need to know is that I'm a cat guy. I've always been a cat guy. And whatever psychology you think that points to, feel free to leap to those conclusions, because I imagine that it probably applies very much. When I was little, we had Dusty the cat, who was gray. who you could literally was so docile you could pick him up and wear him like a stole and walk around. And my 8-year-old self would do that often and think that was pretty keen. And at bedtime we had a thing where I would find Dusty wherever he was and bring him to his food bowl so that he could have dinner. And then when he started to walk away, I would scoop him up and take him, and I would go to bed and he would lay right on my head, and that's how he would go to sleep. When I was in college, I had Jingle the cat, who we gave to my mom as a gift for Christmas, and my mom said, please take this cat with you when you go. And so I did, and I lived in a small apartment in New York City, and Jingle lived there too, and she, the great thing about Jingle was she would play fetch, and so you could wad up a little piece of paper and throw it down the hallway, and she would go, and there was an area rug there, you know, like 10 feet long, and she would reach into it, fly around, and then she would bring the ball back, and just as cats do, would leave it just out of your reach, and then you could go and get it and play again until she wouldn't bring it back, and then, just like a cat, she was telling you very clearly, we're done here. Jingle also liked pizza, which I thought was great, and the nice thing, too, was that I could give her pieces of the pizza, and then I would be like, okay, we're done, and she wouldn't whine anymore, she would just go away and sit down, that would be lovely. We had Jingle. My family had Dot and Paisley, who were enormous cats. By my consideration, I know people have had larger than 18-pound cats, but for me, that was a big cat. Paisley belonged to my wife, and we used to say that Paisley was all the benefits of a dog in the handy convenience of a cat, because he was a dog cat. He would follow her around. He would go to the door when her car came up the driveway. He would wait for her. And also Dot, who is still with us, is the same for my son, Asher. And when he was going to school, she would wait by the door. She knew when 4 o'clock was rolling around. She would wait for him, follow him around, the whole deal. So that was handy, but my wife insisted that they weren't actually dogs. Okay, I understood that, but aren't we doing okay? And she wants a dog. She wanted a dog. She's wanted a dog her whole life. She's never had a dog. I see people with dogs. They seem pretty happy to have their dogs. Good for them. That seems fine. But my wife said, no, it's time. And, you know, life was complicated. She had put this off until she finally found on the internet this face that you see here on the screen, which is Gus. And Gus is magnificent. Gus is incredible. I didn't know I could like a dog as much as I like Gus. He's a lot like a cat, which helps. You know, he plays with things and he bats stuff around and he chases around. He doesn't come when you call him, and so that I'm used to that. And so, you know, this seems pretty kind of along the same lines. But the truth of the matter was that when we first got him home, when this face comes running across the yard at you to say hello, with his ears flopping and his feet going, and he barely even knows how his back end works, then there's something that just happens in our psyche as humans, and we just fall in love. And the thing about that love is that it is so unconditional from the very start, because after all, he's just a dog. And so when things go wrong, when he chews on your slippers, or when he chews on the wall, which was something I didn't realize would happen, that you could actually want to gnaw away at drywall, after all, he's just a dog. And, you know, occasionally, there are accidents in the house, you know what I mean. And that's not something I really wanted to have happen in my house. But after all, you know, he's just a dog. And that happens. Although occasionally, you know, when you catch them and they kind of look at you in the middle of it and they're saying, yeah, you deserve this because you didn't take me out. But then you realize, no, that's what I'm thinking he's thinking. So you quickly become comfortable or aware of what projection is with a puppy. Because if I am frustrated, or I am needing to be somewhere, or I am offended because he doesn't come when I call, I recognize immediately all of that is on me. Because after all, he's just a dog. And this dog has one purpose on the planet. And that is to give anyone who comes in contact with him, primarily my wife and me and my son, the opportunity to be aware of all of those lessons that I'm projecting, that he only has one purpose on this earth, which is to provide me with the love and the opportunity to be loving, and that he's doing the best that he can. And that's amazing, because these are the fundamental realizations that I can carry out into the world and understand what the holy relationship is, what the mind of God is calling me to do, and what my function in human form is. I promised I'd try to take some of the complexity out of A Course in Miracles and make it really functional right now, because we need that. Not just theory, we need action. We need to know what to do and how to do it. And it occurred to me a month ago, and I've just been basking in it ever since, that Gus could be the perfect way to show the true simplicity and power of the love that we're being asked to bring all of the time. Gus has his own Instagram, by the way. GusGus, _ my pup. You can follow him. He's there. He's ready to bring you all of this love, too. The holy relationship sounds complicated, but we can narrow it down. We can get it into these specific things when we use something like this as an example. Gus goes outside and gets distracted and wants to chomp on walnuts and eat rocks. That seems odd to me, and I want to throw a lot of judgment into that, and I want it to be something different. And I realize he's just a dog. Course in Miracles reminds us in its chapter on the holy relationship that before a holy relationship, there is no sin. One of the things we have to do when we talk about Course in Miracles is let go of these trigger words. Oh, no sin, no sin in the world. That doesn't seem quite right. Sin just means a missing of the mark. It's not a major thing. The form of error that we could see in Gus, please don't poop there, is no longer seen. And reason, he's just a dog, joined with love, looks quietly on any confusion and merely observes, this was a mistake. How powerful are for us as people to take any of the drama of our relationships, any of the could-be's and the should-be's and the woulds and the sins and the rights and the wrongs and the judgments, and sum it down with some reason and love into, this was a mistake. This was a mistake. Now, let's not fall down this hole that happens a lot in these conversations. Wait, no sin, no mistakes, no nothing. Oh, then everything is okay? Then any behavior is fine? Then as long as I react with love, it's okay for me to be in an abusive position or to be in a diminished position or to be in a denied position or to be in a lacking position or to be under the subjugation of anyone else. Okay, let's not get ridiculous. That's the ego trying to tell you that love isn't powerful enough to overcome whatever it is that's happening. But let's separate the power of unconditional love and atonement and the holy relationship from the form of any relationship. We won't give in to this absurdity that it's okay to be abused or to be diminished or to be denied your rights. We will know that the form of those things are a mistake. And when mistakes are made, we choose different until we are in a place where no one is denying us our rights or diminishing us or abusing us or causing us trauma. We're not forgiving or giving up on all of those goals in life. That's your ego tricking you into, well, this can't be that powerful because this still exists. No, it is that powerful, and it will overcome that in time. What happens is when reason is joined with love and it just merely observes this was a mistake, then atonement can happen at one moment, knowing that we are one with the other, knowing that as we are holy and Christ-like, so too are they. As we are worthy of love, so too are they. We provide that love, and then the relationship corrects the error and lays part of heaven in its place. The part of heaven being the unconditional love. The part of heaven being this new awareness. The part of heaven being this new acceptance of our responsibility in human form as holy beings in human form to make a difference in the world, to bring this love here no matter what. This week I watched a rather extraordinary documentary on Netflix called My Octopus Teacher. And there's lots of lessons in it. A man named Craig Foster, who's a documentarian, nature documentarian from South Africa, it tells the story that begins with his own personal struggles, that life is complicated is the easiest way to say it, and that sometimes we get burnt out and tired. And he wasn't sure what to do, but he went back to his childhood home, which is on the coast of the Atlantic Ocean in South Africa, and he had previously been a diver in these seas as a child and as a young man, and he had moved away from that. And he had recognized his desire to come back to being at one with the power of God. And in his world, that was to swim in the Atlantic Ocean in among these amazing kelp forests that were right outside his door, literally. Recognize that the Atlantic Ocean is cold, number one, and he goes and talks about that distinctly. You have to overcome the cold. And not only that, but learn to embrace the way it invigorates your life. That these things happening, these coldnesses in our lives, these events that happen, that we submerge ourselves in, are the reason we are alive. They are the thing that makes us alive. And the second remarkable thing about the way he dove was he dove unencumbered, meaning no scuba tank, no backup oxygen. He trained himself to be at one and fully immersed in nature. And he didn't want anything, no wetsuit, no scuba tank, no blowing bubbles to interfere with his immersion into this place. And he trained himself, and they never really say specifically how long he was able to hold his breath, but clearly it's a long time at a time. And after a while, after a number of days, he happens upon a remarkable structure that he's never seen before, rocks and shells and all these different things that are all kind of glommed together in a way that doesn't make sense, that doesn't seem quite natural, that seems a little bit out of place, and he focuses his camera on it, and he's narrating it. I had no idea really what I was looking at, and then all of a sudden, out of the blue, all of those things are dropped by the octopus that was holding them, and the octopus skates off and goes off into the world. And he's like, wow, that's amazing. How does that even happen? What even just happened? And he decides, on a whim, on a sort of a crazy what-if, what if I went to that same place every day for a year and discovered what I could discover there about this octopus? And so that's what he does over the course of 321 days or so. Now, an octopus's lifespan is only about a year anyway, so he was able to see most of this octopus's life. And he engages in it in such a way that is miraculous and wonderful. It becomes his pet in a very real sense, with the exception of the fact that he takes all responsibility away and merely wants to observe and interact. And the octopus interacts back. The octopus gets over its fear of the unknown. The octopus extends its tentacles. The octopus takes him on journeys. The octopus shows him his life in things that he'd never understood before. He's augmenting this with research of what he knows about octopus life and lifespan and all these sorts of things. But when he's there in this foreign, neutral space, fully immersed in the cold and in the nature, he's just merely experiencing, without any expectation, what is life for this octopus, and of course, all of the creatures that it interacts with, and the great circle of life. He sees the octopus go through trauma, be attacked, and lose a tentacle. He feels the emotion, the struggle of seeing something that he cares deeply about, having to go through pain. And he visits and brings his energy there and watches as another tentacle is grown. How nature provides, how the simple grace and glory of God and peace in nature makes it all work out somehow without his needing to intervene. With only his need to accept the glorious love and energy and beauty that is in God's world there. Now, I don't live near the sea. I don't free dive for minutes at a time. The cold would probably shrug me off. But then Gus came. And in my own house, in my own life, in my own place, I had the same opportunity to release all expectations, to accept the extraordinary beauty of something whose only responsibility is to love and to offer me the opportunity to love, and to forgive all else, and to forgive all else. Occasionally, as someone who has the blessed opportunity to be here and be the person speaking and be a teacher, people will come up to me and ask me the tough questions. Things they're really struggling with, or sometimes just those universal tough questions. It always sometimes makes me think of that old radio show, the car guys, and they had a section, Stump the Chump. And it was, occasionally there's a little Stump the Chump in it, like, oh yeah, David, let's just see. But the one that really rings true so often is, yeah, but what about, yeah, but, I always know it's a good one when it starts with that, but what about those people who are in our lives through happenstance or not or whatever, who just get to you, they come in and they just poop all over your life. What are you supposed to do? How's this supposed to work? What's really going to happen here? Come on. And this is my answer. This is what it is. The ability to understand how one anything, and I know there's one in your life. I know there's someone in your life, or something, or some living presence of God in your life. It's a Gus, or it's an octopus, or it's a grandchild, or it's a child, or it's a partner, or it's a hero, or it's a flower, or it's the hummingbird, or it's the majesty of crops, or wheat, or mountains. I know there's something in your life that when you settle into it and get quiet, it draws up in you the reminder of the God strength that is you. And if you can do that for one thing, then you can do that, I promise you, for everything. Because the process and the feeling and the acceptance and the atonement and the forgiveness are exactly the same. If you need to, say, he's just a dog. If you need to, say, they're just a person. It's just a thing. It's just a driver. It's just a car. It's just a whatever. Wow, it seems like you're really diminishing the value of that person. You just called him a dog. No, actually, I have just elevated the value of that person by equating them to the glory of a pure and beautiful child of God that also happens to be a dog. You see the difference? This is what Course in Miracles is asking you to do. All you need do is dwell in quiet here with Christ and share his vision. All you need do, just like in the meditation we just did, just like in all of the beautiful songs, just like bringing them into our hearts, all you need do is be still and recognize the Christ that is surrounding you. As you are holy, so are they. So is that next living thing. You know, there's a point in the octopus story where he says straight out, you know, people kept asking me, for a year you went back to the same place over and over and over again? And he's like, of course, that's how I really got to know what was there, how all the pieces fit together, how every living thing was important. And what I would say, how every little thing is pure and holy and part of the web, how every little thing deserves our reverence, how every living thing draws us into wonder and glory and love and the peace of Christ. We go back to the same place over and over and over again, don't we? We go to our house, we go to our workplace, we go to our school, we go to these same stores, we come to this same place. Step one, step into these same places over and over and over again with the vision of Christ and see anew the powerful and glorious lights that are there and can lead you to atonement and forgiveness. See God there. See Christ in the face, the image, the life energy of all living things. And then release those expectations. What they should be, what I thought they were there for, what I expect to have happen. Now, in real life, how this also works is with the living things that you interact with, including your dog, you make agreements. You agree that for the betterment of the household, it would be really great if we could agree that you're going to do that outside. We agree that in this relationship, whatever form it is, that I'm going to need this and I can provide that. And if I break that agreement, that's a mistake. And we can either decide if we can atone for that together or atone for it apart. In real life, we agree, both informally in society and very formally in intimate relationships, what it is we're going to do. And when those things, those agreements don't get lived up to, then we make a choice about what we're going to do in that case. But we've released the expectation that any of that is wrong or difficult or damaging or hurtful or painful because we know that that was just a mistake. And with reason and love, what we will do instead is forgive. And maybe big changes will come. Maybe whole life differences will have to happen. Maybe something has to be completely different in the agreements we've made on this form. But in the holy relationship, the purpose and the value and the outcome is the same. It is always that you have the same purpose that Gus has, which is to provide me the opportunity to be unconditionally loving. And when I do that and when I forgive, that is the miracle, pure and simple. That is, I love that phrase, that is laying a part of heaven in its place. That is creating heaven on earth. That is bringing the mind, power, love, and glory of God into reality. That is what we are here to do. Every time we forgive and accept and embrace and love and move forward, and then we accept that glorious and incredible miracle that happens. This is our purpose. And so here you and your brother stand. Here you and all living things stand. Here you and all perceived difficulties, obstacles, separations, hurdles stand. And I get this. This is tough. This is tough to be in a faith practice that accepts all living things as worthy of reverence and love and God. It requires us to open ourselves up to bring all things in and to accept the responsibility for healing and loving them. It happens just like that, though. That's the good news. I get that there are faith practices that allow judgment so we don't have to worry about that group of people anymore. We don't have to be a part of that answer anymore. They're different than us. They aren't us. They're something else. But the lesson of humanity, the lesson of this octopus, is that every single living thing has its place, has its lesson, is deserving of reverence, and is there to help me create the miracle of unconditional loving. When I do that, miracles occur. The energy is shifted. Beautiful things happen. So here we are with this veil of sin between us. Let it be lifted. And think what will happen after. The love of Christ will light your face and shine from it into a darkened world that needs the light. And from this holy place, he will return with you. He, meaning God energy, and will not leave you or the world. You will become his messenger, returning him unto himself. I drive here 3 times a month, and there's this little bitty sign. It's this big. By the side of the road, 40 miles south of Indianapolis or west of east of Indianapolis. And it says, Jesus is coming. And the Jesus is quotes, which I like as someone who loves words, because that means I get to interpret Jesus as whatever I want it to be, because you put it in quotes. I'm crafty that way. So I get to remember every time I pass that sign that the love of God, the Christ consciousness that is exemplified in the story of Jesus, is coming. And it's coming because every time I'm here and every time I choose it, every minute of every day, I see it right before me in you. I know it's coming. I've seen it. I've seen it here already. There's no future tense to the extraordinary love and beauty that you all provide, that you are, that you live, that you enact, that you see. And when we get weary and we need reminders or we need practice, then we'll find Gus. Or you'll find your Gus. Whatever it is that came out of nowhere and is so pure and is such an easy reminder of how great and glorious the living world is. And how profoundly grateful we can be for the love that we can give through it. Whatever it is for you, utilize it as your reminder and then step forth confidently. Because you can do it for one thing means you can do it for everything. And that'll be the difference. Amen.
The world as I see it is a remarkable place, a beautiful house in a forest of stars in outer space. From a bird's eye view, I can see it as a well-rounded personality. From a bird's eye view, I can see we are family. It's not hard for me to love you, hard for me to love you. No, it's not a difficult thing. It's not hard for me to love you, hard for me to love you, because you are the world to me. The world as I see it is a remarkable place. Every man makes a difference, and every mother's child is a saint. From a bird's eye view, I can see we are spiraling down in gravity. From a bird's eye view, I can see you are just like me. It's not hard for me to love you, hard for me to love you. No, it's not a difficult thing. It's not hard for me to love you. Oh, I really love you unconditionally. No, it's not hard for me to love you, hard for me to love you. No, it's not a difficult thing. It's not hard for me to love you. Oh, I really love you. Love you are the world to me. You are the mountain, you are the rock, you are the core, you are the spark. You are the eagle, you are the lark, you are the world and you're remarkable. You're the ocean meeting the shore. You are the calm inside the storm. You're every emotion you can endure. You are the world and the world. It's not hard for me to love you. Oh, I really love you unconditionally. No, it's not hard for me to love you. Hard for me to love you. No, it's not a difficult thing. It's not hard for me to love you. Hard for me to love you. Because you are the one.
Can you sing it with us?
No, it's not hard for me to love you. Hard for me to love you. No, it's not a difficult thing. It's not hard for me to love you. Hard for me to love you. Because you are the world to me. The world as I see it is a remarkable place.
Thank you, everybody. This is that time in our service when we take our offering in our hands or in our mind's eye, however you may be choosing to give. You can give online. You can use our magic machine there in the back. You have, if you have something with you, right now there's a basket in the back. We're not passing during this time. But no matter what it is, what we take into our mind's eye or into our hands or both is the knowledge of the extraordinary abundance of our universe. The gratitude for the prosperity we experience when it comes to us. And the way, the knowledge, the love that we send out with our prosperity to bless the world. We know that this circle is the way it works and that all things come back to us many, many fold when they are sent out with the glorious power of love. And we infuse that love into our offering at this time. And in the tradition of unity, we say together this prayer. Divine love moving in and through me blesses and multiplies all that I give and all that I receive. Amen. I want to remind you of the extraordinary power of prayer, the ability to consciously utilize the energy of the universe and the love of God in order to know all things good as our inheritance from the universe and the mind of God. This center runs on prayer, and if you are here, there's always a prayer card in front of you that you can fill out and deposit in the box in the back. You can also utilize the grace and love of our prayer chaplains, who are always up in front after the service. If you are virtual, you can put a prayer message in the chat right now if that feels comfortable to you, or send an email. It will get to the right place, and the prayer chaplains work diligently to make certain not only that your thoughts, concerns, and celebrations are held in loving thought, but that they're distributed to many others who also do the same all around the world for at least a month. And we know the miracles that occur because of this energy and this investment in the glory of God. So please take advantage of that loving service.
Yes, and my cousin Marilyn is here today as a prayer chaplain. Hey, cuz. We're two Kaisers in one place. She spells her name a little different, but that's okay. We're all one, right? And So, if you're out there in virtual land, do a like or repost or get the word out that some really good things happen here on Sunday morning, and all for everyone, whether you're here present or virtually, check out the website and all the happenings that are happening. Now we got a couple more things, and we're going to do our prayer for protection and our peace song. But I wanted to thank Susan and Rick back there with all the tech and the slides. And I wanted to thank my the band, the best band anywhere on a Sunday morning, sits right here in this. And our singers, and we have two things going on. It's Alice's birthday today. Happy
Yay!
Birthday, Alice.
Happy Alice, yes.
And there's something we need to know about Althea, and Flo is here from the board.
And David, I'm sorry. It's also our board member Kim Ballou's birthday today.
What?
I know. Is it anybody else's birthday? We
Kim,
don't want to leave anybody.
It's your birthday too today?
This very day.
Well, you guys, you're twins? I did not know that. And come on up. We have an announcement about Althea. I think we do. She's going to need a microphone, somebody.
Good morning, everyone. As many of you may be aware, the board decided a few weeks back to put a call out for an additional board member. And fortunately for us, someone has stepped forward to fill that position, and I'm pleased to announce that that person is our one and only Althea Palmer. And we are really excited to have her join the group and contribute her service to the Board of Trustees. Thank you. Thank you so much.
All right.
Here.
We want to thank everyone for coming and being part of the service today. We welcome you back. JJ is back with her own brand of laying the word down and raising the roof at the same time next week. And so that's going to be a whole lot of fun. And so let's stand and know our prayer for protection. And as we do so, I just want to say hello to Grandma Jo out there. Everybody say hello, Grandma Jo.
Hello, Grandma Jo.
For Grandma Joe and everyone else, let's extend and in a virtual circle hold ourselves and all creation as we know together our prayer for protection. And we know,
the light of God surrounds me, the love of God enfolds me, the power of God protects me, the presence of God watches over me, wherever I am, God is. And all is well.
Well.
earth and let